from the coffee. You go ahead and take a seat. So welcome. So this is our award ceremony. It's where we honor all sorts of people. We've got lots of awards to hand out. I think it's wonderful for we have awards for students, early career people, and we're going to get to our ICO-ICTP Gallieno Denardo Award later. But first, before we do anything, we have a special guest online. That's the director, Atish Debokar, of the ICTP. And I think Atish will give a few words of welcome. Atish, if you unmute.
Yes. Hi. Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yes. Perfect.
Can you hear us? Okay. Hey. So welcome, everybody. Good afternoon. So I'm very happy today we are celebrating. I mean, we are awarding these awards in the memory of the late Professor Gallieno Denardo. The International Commission for Optics, ICO and ICTP, established the award in 2000. And in September 2007, we agreed to dedicate it to the memory and legacy of Professor Denardo, who greatly contributed to the development of optics research within ICTP and in developing countries. This ICO-ICTP Denardo Award is given to researchers from developing countries who are under 40 years of age on 31st December of the year in which the award is given, and who are active in optics and photonics research and have contributed to the promotion of research activities in their own or another developing country. ICTP underlines the importance of prizes for recognition of merit in the field of optics. And I would like to acknowledge the support of international organizations such as SPIE, Optica, ICO, SIOF, and others in helping ICTP reach out to the numerous young scientists around the world working on optics and its applications. So related to this important field of research is ICTP's hosting of the Global Secretariat of the UN International Year of Light and Light-Based Technology. And also ICTP is a partner in UNESCO's International Day of Light. So let me quickly say a few words about the awardees this year. So for... For 2021, David Hayrapetyan from Russian-Armenian University at Yerevan, Armenia, has been awarded the 2021 ICO-ICTP Gallieno Denardo Award. Then for 2022, V.R. Supradipa from the Center for Nanoscience and Engineering, IISc Bangalore, India, has been awarded the 2022 ICO-ICTP Gallieno Denardo Award. And as I understand, Supradipa is connected via Zoom. So congratulations. And for the 2023 ICO-ICTP Gallieno Denardo Award is given to Muhammad Kasim Mahmood from the Information Technology Institute of the Punjab at Lahore, Pakistan. And Hayrapetyan and Kasim Mahmood are in the Budinich Hall in person. I'm sorry that I cannot join you in person, but I will be represented by the head of research and partnership of ICTP, Professor Sandro Scandolo, and Professor Joe Nimela will be the moderator for the remaining ceremony. So I'm looking forward to your talks and congratulations once again.
Thanks very much, Atish. Okay, so before we're going to do the formal promotion of the certificates, but before we do that, I would like to acknowledge some of our some of the participants that are here. Who you guys gave talks and you presented posters, and we went around. It wasn't me, but it was others. went around and took a look. And so we've made some awards there. These are awards sponsored by SBIE and Optica. On your behalf, for everybody, we actually had our nice ice cream social. That was brought to you by SBIE and Optica during the second poster session. So I'd like to invite up Katarina Svanberg, past president of SBIE from Lund University, and she's going to present the poster prizes.
I am really delighted and very, very happy to be here and to have the position of seeing all you young, talented. You are the one who should take over the science when we don't do it anymore. So you are extremely important for the future. And for your own career, of course, for your university, for your institutions, for your organizations. We are in a very special situation here, listening to UNESCO officials giving us so important information. So you are very, very lucky, all of you who have the opportunity to be here and to be trained by these skilled people, all the nice lecturers. But you are also very skilled yourself, and that's the reason why we now will give out prizes. Unfortunately, not all can win a prize. That's too bad. But some of you will. And I will give out the poster presentation prizes. And this is a joint venture in between Optica, where we have Anthony Johnson here, former president of Optica, and SBIE. Both these learned societies really would like to support science, optics, photonics all over the world. Okay, so I start with third place poster award. And that is awarded to Elbir Oyama for the poster entitled Quantum Correlation Under the Effect of a Thermal Environment in a Triangular Optomechanical Cavity. Okay, so take this as real recognition for your work. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. And now we take the next one, that's also a third place, awarded to Ben Brick-Sara for the poster entitled Contribution of the UV visible hair fluorescence spectrometry in systemic lupus erythematosus, SLE, a very important aspect, I would say, as a medical doctor, diagnosis and follow-up. So please come forward and receive your certificate. Congratulations.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you.
Now we move on to the second place of the poster award here, and that is awarded to Bovmik Brasov Kumar for the poster entitled High Q Resonating All Dielectric Metamaterial for Refractive Index Sensing. First boy. Oops. It's wrong.
The poster title, whatever I presented, it was on the.
So maybe you should, we should write one more poster title, but this is your poster.
Yes.
Okay. Anyway, so congratulations for every poster that you presented. And now comes first place. Awarded to Tanti Van Chapan Kwavan Shai for the poster entitled Terahertz Metamaterial Base Detector and Sensing Application.
Thank you.
Please. I am really happy to see three girls out of the four winners. So Women in Optics has something to play, really. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Anthony Johnson, and I have the pleasure of awarding the prizes for the oral talks. And I'd like to say that it is really a pleasure to be back here. I was here in 2020, just before the pandemic really hit. But I am an old timer. I've been coming to this meeting for well over 20 years. We've also been working with SPIE the entire time. We're strong partners on this. I am at the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. I am a professor of physics and electrical engineering. And as I was president of Optica in 2002, so a long time ago. So it is a pleasure to award the posters and the oral prizes. So this is the oral presentation award, and third place winner, the first one is Rajat Kumar. And the title of the talk, Study of Different Stages of Wound Healing in Mice Skin by Terahertz Time Domain Spectroscopy. Yes, okay. You're welcome. For second place, we have Jared Umbiro Guaro for his work, continuous wave terahertz source based on electrically tunable monolithic two-color laser diode. You have to hold it, turn it so it can be seen. Congratulations.
Thanks.
Congratulations. For first place, we have Anjana Bhattacharya for the work entitled Logic Gate Operations in a Terahertz Toroidal Meta Device.
Congrats.
And now we have another first place prize given to Martin Alonso Garo Gonzalez. And the talk is entitled Photo-induced bending of microfabricated films of high-performance AZO materials. That does it for the oral and poster presentations. And we look forward to the rest of the ceremony.
Well, thanks a lot, Anthony and Katharina. And congratulations, poster and talk winners. We're going to announce one more winner, and that's the popular winner amongst the judges and some of the participants. For the poster. And so this is actually a very important one because this is one where we all kind of agreed, and we like to call it the people's choice because we got a lot of input from people around. So and I'm sorry I don't have the certificate with you. Sarah Kobe, come around. Please come down, please. Sarah. We will rectify that. In a second, I'm sorry, it wasn't in our package, but congratulations, as no means. Okay, so let's take a picture. Sandro, wanna come over here? You. Thank you, congratulations. All right, well, now we're gonna move on to, Atish has already announced, our director, Professor Dabakar, has announced the ICTP Gallieno Denardo Prize awardees. And he also gave the, so you understand, it's an early career prize or award. And that's something very important for us to give you a boost in your careers. And I want to take the opportunity to say, if you have any, if you're not 40 and coming by December 31st next year, please think about not self-nominating, but finding somebody to nominate you, or you could nominate somebody else. But just think about it, because we're always looking for talented young people, early career scientists. And if you want, you know, when you get your award, you can put it up on the wall, or you can put it in a desk drawer. But the main point is you have that and you should use it. You should abuse it in any way you can, and usually to help young people. And so all of our awardees this year, and well, from 2021, 22, and 23, are all recognized for helping young people, underrepresented groups, et cetera. Now you can use the award to even further do that. I think everybody should use their position as you grow older and older to try to help young people who just need a hand. They will help themselves, but you can help them, and you can use your award to actually add a little punch to your message. So I would like to come up. I'd like to invite our awardees to come up, and we'll take a picture. VR Superdeepa was unfortunately not able to come, but I presented his certificate at Photonics West in San Francisco a couple of weeks ago. So, but he will join us for an online talk. So first, I'd like to invite David Hayrapetyan up here. And so he's our 2021 winner. Please come. Okay, you need to take that. So he's been waiting a long time. Unfortunately, we wanted to make sure that our prize winners, award winners, were here in person. And I think it's only fitting that they can give a talk here and not online. So at any rate, Sandro. The most important thing. There's a coupon for some pizza. No, I'm just kidding. Thank you very much. Congratulations. And we'll have your talk a little bit later. So also here is the 2023 recipient. And that is Mohammed Kazem Mahmoud. And Mohammed, is it? And don't forget this. Okay, so we're perfectly on time. How did that happen? All right, so now I'd like to invite our awardees to come up and give a 30-minute presentation on their work. So first of all, David, you have the floor, and I guess you're all set up.
Is this a pointer? Which one? This one?
This is the pointer. Keep pressed.
Yeah.
This is forward and backwards.
Okay. 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 Can I start the presentation? Okay. Thank you. Thank you, dear chairman, for introducing me. And first of all, I would like to express my thanks to ICO-ICTP selection committee for choosing me for this prize. This is honor for me. And of course, I'm thankful for the nomination to ICO-ICTP local presenters, Professor Aram Papoyan and Naine Geverkan, also Professors David Blaschke and Sotirios Baskutas for the recommendation and for the support. Okay, let's start the presentation. So the title of my presentation is Generalization of Kohn Theorem for Lens-Shaped Quantum Dots. I'll present theory and experiment, which I'm theoretician, but experimental part have been done by our partners. I'm from Yerevan, and this is the ruins and old cuneiform from the Yerevan, and Yerevan founded in 782 BC. And this is nowadays views from the Yerevan. Here you can see Biblic Mountain Ararat, and of course, I'm inviting you to Yerevan. This is Russian-Armenian University. I'm working in this university. And in Armenia, there are four transnational universities, Russian-Armenian University, American University, French University, and European Regional University. And this is connected with the diaspora because Armenians have big diasporas in all these countries, in Russia, USA, France, and of course, all over the Europe, especially in Italy. I'm presenting the research group, and the main investigation topics of this group is theoretical and computational investigation of electronic, magnetic, optical, and statistical properties of quantum nanostructures. So this is the outline of my presentation. Now let's pass to the research part of my presentation. As you know, development in quantum nanotechnologies make it possible to grow semiconductor quantum nanostructures with different properties, different shapes, sizes, and so on. Here are some examples. You can see here quantum wells, quantum wires, spherical quantum dots. You can see FEM images of these structures and also geometrical structure that can be used for the theoretical modeling. Here you can see cylindrical, conical, pyramidal, ellipsoidal, quantum lenses, quantum rigs, and so on. And these structures, they have many applications and many different areas, for example, in quantum computing, for example, in photonics to enhance the optical devices, in sensing to develop high sensitive sensors, in energy harvesting, for example, in PV cells of new generation, in spintronics, in medical diagnosis, for example, for targeted drug delivery and so on, in environmental monitoring. So it means that investigation of these structures are still hot topic, and there are many interesting applications. And today I want to present you interesting and beautiful effect which have been found by Walter Kohn, Nobel Prize winner Walter Kohn, in 1961. So in 1961, he published a paper devoted to the investigation of electron gas in the presence of external magnetic field. And Kohn found out that in this system, the cyclotron resonance frequency is independent of the interaction, which means that this resonance, cyclotron resonance, is not affected by the interaction potential between the particles. Yeah, it means that the many body system acts like single particle. In 1990, Maxim and Chakraborty generalized this theorem, Kohn's theorem, for the quantum dots. And they found out that the optical excitation energy for many body system in quantum dots in the external magnetic field has the same as for single electron. So it means that we cannot understand is there a single particle in the quantum dot or many body system. Yeah. In the same year, Peters generalized the theorem for the asymmetric parabolic confinement potential. You can ask how this parabolic confinement potential can be formed in quantum dots. Here, I present a spherical quantum dot with this parabolic potential. And this can be formed during the grow process of quantum dot. So because of interdiffusion between the quantum dot material and environmental material, the confinement potential occurs, and which can be modeled with the help of, for example, parabolic potential. Here you can see band structure with sharp edges, but in reality, because of this interdiffusion between two materials, it's more realistic to model this problem with confinement potential, with parabolic confinement potential. In 2013 and 2016, our group continued these works, and we implement Kohn's theorem for the case of ellipsoidal quantum dots. Here you can see without external magnetic field, and the same with external magnetic field. So there are two main differences between these works. First, of course, this is the shape of quantum dot. This is ellipsoidal, not spherical one. And the second main point difference between these problems, that we consider rectangular confinement potential. So you can ask a question, where is the parabolic potential, which is important for the implementation and for the realization of Kohn's theorem. Let's stop in this question, and we'll come back to this question after some slides. Now I want to present some experimental part from our partners. Our partners, they can grow with the help of, for example, molecular beam epitaxy method, different quantum structures. For example, here you can see quantum lenses, and quantum lenses made of indium arsenide, germanium, silicon, and different materials. And the first that you can see that all these structures, they have a blade character. It means that the height of the quantum lens is much less than the radius, base radius, okay? For example, here I present some experimental parameters, grow temperature, dot material. And you can see here that with the help of doping, our partners, they can change the number of holes, number of heavy holes in quantum dots, for example, 0, 2, 4, 6, and so on. Yeah. And here the average sizes of quantum dots. So it goes from 5 to 10 nanometers in the radius and about 3 nanometer in height. And our partners, they can also, experimental collaborators, they can also make some measurements, optical absorption measurements in mid-IR spectra. I can't go deeper in experimental part because I'm a theoretician. So let's go to the theoretical part. After these experiments, we decided to model the structure. So here you can see asymmetric biconvex lens. So we model the general case. And as I already mentioned, we take rectangular potential. It means that potential is zero inside the quantum dot and infinite outside the quantum dot. Before starting to solve the many body problem, I want to present you geometrical adiabatic approximation shortly, because the single particle problem in this structure, it cannot be solved exactly. Yeah, that is why we should use some approximation method. So geometrical adiabatic approximation method, it's about dividing our system into two parts. Since we have a blade character in our quantum dot, it means that the motion of our particle in axial direction will be faster than in radial direction. So we can divide it Hamiltonian into H1. This is Hamiltonian of fast subsystem, and H2, Hamiltonian of slow subsystem. X, this is coordinate of fast subsystem, and Xi, coordinate of the slow subsystem. And this is the part, the interaction, this is the part that describe the interaction between our systems. I want to mention that this is approximation for the same particle, not, this is the not different particles. This is this approximation for the same particle. So what the essence of this approximation? Firstly, we will consider Hamiltonian for the fast subsystem, and solving Schrodinger equation for the fast subsystem, we can get the energies, the eigenvalues and eigenstates for the fast subsystem, E and one and C and one. Then we can construct the full system wave function. It will be the sum. It will be sum from all our wave functions. Then we will do the first approximation. We will take only the first term from this sum. Yeah, and then putting it into the Schrodinger equation or the whole system, we can make the second approximation, since the parameter psi, the coordinate psi, is acting as parameter for the fast subsystem. We can consider operator H2, action of operator H2, only on the wave function of slow subsystem. After this, we can multiply Schrodinger equation by the conjugate wave function and integrate this by the fast coordinate x. Then we will get this equation. Here, the first integral is just the energy of the fast subsystem, E and x. And second and third integrals, they are equal to one because of normalization. So taking these integrals into account, we'll get final result. This is the Schrodinger equation for the slow subsystem. And now you can see that the energy of the fast subsystem, which we call effective potential or adiabatic potential, this is acting as potential for the slow subsystem. So the essence of geometric adiabatic approximation, as a first step, we should consider Schrodinger equation for the fast subsystem, then getting the energy as effective potential, putting it into the Schrodinger equation of the slow subsystem, then finally we get energy and the wave function of the whole system. So the advantages and disadvantages of this method. First, this is in this approximation, the interaction between systems are not assumed to be small, and this is some part of incomplete separation of variables. The only disadvantage that we can use this approximation method when our system has prolate or ablate character. As I already show you in experiments, yeah, we have for quantum lenses, we have such prolate structure, then we can use this approximation. Sorry for technical problems here. So here you can see the Hamiltonian of the many body system. We have n holes in our system, and this term presenting the kinetic energy, this is confinement energy of the particles, and this is interaction between all the particles. Before many body problem, considering many body problem, we can solve single particle problem. And here we write the Schrodinger equation in cylindrical coordinates for the one hole, and the wave function we can present, as I already mentioned, because of geometrical adiabatic approximation, because of this oblate character, as a product of axial and radial parts. And then this is the cross section of our quantum lens. Here H1, H2, R1, R2 are the geometrical parameters of our quantum lens. And here you can see that as a fast subsystem, we can consider the motion in axial direction. Yeah, since we have a blade character. And it means that as a first step, we should solve Schrodinger equation with one-dimensional, well, with such thickness. And then we can finally get wave function and energy spectrum for fast subsystem. As you remember from adiabatic approximation method, this is the effective potential for the slow subsystem. Putting it into the slow subsystem, we can finally get the energy. But before, here it should be return R is much less than R0. We can expand this potential into the Taylor series since because of the acting of quantum wells, quantum dot wells, the particle mainly will be localized in the center of the quantum dot. So by the expansion into the Taylor series, we will get this parabolic potential, some parameter alpha plus beta rho square. So this is the answer for the question. So where is the parabolic potential? Here you can see parabolic potential with the parameter omega. And you can see that's, that parameter omega depends only on geometrical parameters of our system. And finally, we can get the energy spectrum of the whole system. And now coming back to the many particle problem, we can write that the energy of particle in axial direction is much more than the interparticle interaction, because in axial direction, we have strong size quantization regime. It means that, well, it means that instead of the potential interaction potential, 3D interaction potential, we can consider 2D potential. So it means that interaction can be considered only in the radial plane. And in this case, we can write down wave function and energy for the many body particle problem as a product of wave functions from a single particle problem and the sum of the energies from the many particle problem, single particle problem. And by analogy, we can, by analogy with single particle problem, we can consider parameter omega. In this case, our Hamiltonian, 2D Hamiltonian, will be in this form. So kinetic part, confinement part, and 2D interaction part between all particles. Okay, now let's come to the implementation of Kohn's theorem, how we can implement it. First, let's consider the same system, but without interparticle interaction. So in this case, the Hamiltonian of the system will be H0 2D, it means two-dimensional and without interaction. So here we have only kinetic part and confinement part. And this Hamiltonian can be exactly diagonalized with the help of creation and annihilation operator, C plus and C minus. In this case, our Hamiltonian will be as written here. And now we, by the direct calculations, we can show that commutational relations between interparticle potential and annihilation and creation operator C plus C minus, they're equal to zero. While the Hamiltonian commutation for the non-interacting gas with C plus C minus is equal to plus minus H omega. It means that for the interaction Hamiltonian here, we can write down, it can be presented that as a Hamiltonian for the non-interacting part plus interaction part. And since this part is zero commutation, this part is H plus minus H omega, we get the same result, yeah? As for gas with interparticle interaction and without interparticle interaction. What it means? It means that if we'll consider the state for the non-interparticle state or non-particle gas with the energy is zero, then acting by the creation operator C plus, we will get the, this energy plus H omega. While for the C minus annihilation operator, we will get E zero minus H omega. The same result will be for our system with interparticle interaction. If we have state F with energy E, then acting by the creation operator C plus, we'll get energy plus H omega. And here we'll get energy minus H omega. Now let's consider the long wave radiation. The incident light will fall on the quantum dot perpendicular to the radial plane. And then we can consider additional Hamiltonian H prime, like here written. This is a sign of the vector, where E, this is electric field, and the E zero is an amplitude. It means that in our case, we can represent coordinates X and Y with the help of C plus and C minus annihilation and creation operators. And acting by this Hamiltonian on our system, in this system with the interacting part and non-interacting part, we'll get the same result. It means that these all transitions will get equal to H omega, where the omega is, you remember, the parameter that depends on geometrical parameters of the quantum dot. So it means that we can calculate now H omega. Sorry for these technical problems. H omega, we can calculate it putting some parameters from the experiment, for example, effective masses for the holes, for example, H and R geometrical sizes of quantum dot. And then we get about 31 millielectron volt. While in the experiment, our partners, they measured about 30 millielectron volts. Here you can see experimental results for two heavy holes, for four heavy holes, six heavy holes. In all cases, you can see that these transitions occurs for the same energy. So after this, our partners make more experiments for different temperatures, and you can see always the same results, and also with different energies or powers. So the important provisions in this case, that in all cases, our quantum dots contains few particle gas. Namely, we consider gas of heavy holes. And second, that the effective masses of particles are scalar. The third one, that quantum dots has specific geometry, yeah? They have ablate character, which allows us to divide particle motion into the fast and slow subsystems. And the fourth one, incident perturbation is long wavelength. All these conditions are satisfied in our case. And the conclusion that there is a certain energy range where the motion of holes in germanium silicon quantum dots is equivalent to the motion of 2D particles in parabolic potential, which allows us to implement Kohn's theorem. We published these results in 2018, and I want to thank my colleagues, Hayk Sarkisyan and Edward Kazanyan from my university. Edward Kazanyan, who was my supervisor and head of our group, Ludwig Petrosyan from Jackson State University, USA, professors Dmitry Firsev, Leonid Vorobyov, and PhD Roman Balagula and Anton Safronov from Peter's the Great, St. Petersburg University, and Alexander Tonkich, who grew the structures from Ostrom. And since today is St. Valentine's Day, I want to finish my talk by sending congratulations to my wife. She's,
thank you.
She's also a physicist and my colleague. Thank you very much.
Thank you much, David. I thought you were gonna start giving kisses out. All right, so. Thank you. Okay, it's open questions. Anybody? Yes. Questions always come from the opposite end of the room and up at the top.
Thank you, Mr. David. So it's more like a clarification. I need a clarification or something. You mentioned for the first case without perturbation, you mentioned you got your result was H omega. And then still after perturbation with an external field, you still have the same H omega.
Yes.
So I'm not sure how, like, how did you model your system with the external potential?
Not before and after perturbation, but taking into account interaction between particles and without interaction, it's the same.
Okay.
So it means that if you have many particles, you will measure some optical transmission, yeah? And if you will have single particle and you will have the same measurement, so you will get the same result. And if the Kohn's theorem is realized for this case, you cannot differ these two options.
Okay. So what if in a case where you have like an evolution of the system due to like perturbation by like an external field?
Perturbation, just long wave radiation. This is the long wave radiation that incided on our system.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, other questions? You can think about it while I'm walking down the stairs. Anybody? Buddy? Okay, well, again, David, congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you very,
thank
very,
you
nice
very much.
Talk.
Thank okay. you very much.
Thanks. Okay, now we're gonna move to Super Deepa. He's online. Okay, so yeah.
Yes. I'll share my screen now.
Yes, go ahead.
Is this visible?
Yes, it is. It's not in presentation mode, but yeah, we see it.
Okay, great. How about now?
Yes, now we see it in presentation.
Perfect.
Okay, well, anyway, I'll reintroduce you again. This is VR Super Deepa from the Center for Nanoscience and Engineering at the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore. And Super Deepa is our 2022 recipient, but unfortunately, you know, we had COVID, we had all virtual college that year. And then we just saw each other in Photonics West in San Francisco. So that was nice. So you got your certificate there. But
yes.
But unfortunately, you know, with one passport, it's pretty hard to get a visa and go and around the world. So at any rate, welcome, Super Deepa, and we're looking forward to your lecture.
Thank you very much, Joe. And thank you, everyone, for coming to my talk. More importantly, it's an honor to be a recipient of the 2022 Gallieno Denardo Award, and also for having this opportunity to talk to all of you participating in this exciting winter school, which unfortunately I was not able to attend. So getting with my talk, I'm from the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore, and my work is mainly on a certain laser technology referred to as cascaded Raman fiber lasers, which I will hopefully over the next 30 minutes use this time to motivate why we are working on this and what are the interesting results that we have seen. So before I even talk about that, the sort of the general category this belongs to is high-power fiber lasers. I'm sure this is something relatively common. Some reason my mode is not working. Just give me a second. Yeah. So fiber lasers is basically a very important high-power laser technology, which was anticipated to be even 2019 was like a multi-billion dollar industry. So what are some important applications of fiber lasers? So all this industrial type processes, laser cutting, welding, drilling of metallic objects right now is mainly done with fiber lasers working in the NIR wavelength region. There are of course defense applications, LIDAR, laser weapons and so on, which quite a few different countries in the world are working on. Then of course, free space communications, and very scientific applications such as laser guide star and so on. So this is sort of general introduction to fiber lasers, but what exactly is a fiber laser? So the technology of a fiber laser is where we have an optical fiber, which has a core, which is doped with a rare earth material. And what it actually does is it takes a low brightness light from pump laser diodes, which is multi-mode. So it cannot really be used for any of the applications we talked about because of relatively large focused spots that it can create because of multi-modedness, and converts it into a very bright single mode. So basically a fiber laser is largely a mode converter, and it takes this highly multi-moded light and makes it into a nice single-moded beam. So that's basically fiber lasers. But where do we currently stand with fiber lasers is there's a lot of inherent advantages with ytterbium doped fibers, because of which we can get thousands of watts at the ytterbium wavelength. But beyond that, in the near infrared region, there are a lot of white spaces, basically, where no laser technology which works at similar high power levels is available. But this is sort of a disadvantage because, you know, at different parts of the laser spectrum, you basically have additional advantages such as eye safety, which is particularly important when you're looking at high power lasers, or what is the transparency in the atmosphere for these high power laser sources. So, but even more bothersome is the fact that every wavelength that you use, you need a different laser. So in a laboratory, you can imagine if I'm working in fiber laser applications, then for every wavelength region, I have a completely different module I will acquire because it's made from completely different technologies. So the question is, can I get something which sort of spans this entire wavelength region? And it turns out there is such a laser technology called Raman fiber lasers, which can span this entire region with a single module. So how exactly does Raman fiber lasers work? Basically, it's built on the principle of Raman scattering. This is C.V. Raman, who, coincidentally, was a professor and the director of the Indian Institute of Science. So in a way, I'm working on Raman-based lasers, a few blocks away from where Raman did the experiments when he was here. So any material basically has Raman gain, which is optical phonon scattering. And so what we can do is we can start with a high power laser, which is accessible, let's say the ytterbium doped fiber laser, and then use a series of cascaded Raman shifts to reach these wavelength regions that are inaccessible. So that's basically the principle of cascaded Raman lasers. So how was that historically implemented is through what is known as a cascaded Raman resonator. So we basically come in with light, let's say at 1117 nanometers, which comes out of an ytterbium doped fiber laser. And then it goes into this cavity with multiple fiber Bragg gratings at exactly spaced one Raman shift apart at all these intermediate wavelengths. So the light comes in, and then because of Raman gain, it sort of converts progressively into longer and longer Stokes. And at the output, what you end up getting is most of the light resting in the final wavelength for which this cascaded Raman resonator is designed. And the fiber that you use is just a passive fiber with a small effective area, also sometimes referred to as a Raman fiber, which enhances the Raman gain in this material. But otherwise, it's just a conventional small effective area fiber, step index fiber. So some salient points. The idea of a Raman resonator was proposed early in 1993 in Bell Labs, where they demonstrated a 1-watt level system, which scaled up to 40 watts in 2007. But the efficiencies were relatively low, 30%. And more importantly, the resonator architecture is very unstable at higher powers. The reason is, you have the ytterbium doped laser, which is a cavity, and the cascaded Raman resonator, which is another cavity. And then there is sort of this inter-cavity sort of push-pull oscillations that arise which can destabilize the system. So this is exactly the point at which I started working on this system. So what do we have as a wish list for cascaded Raman lasers is, of course, as with any laser technology, we want higher efficiency, higher power. But what I'll be talking mainly about in today's talk is how do I enhance the agility of these lasers by accessing different wavelength bands and also hopefully continuously tune. So basically have a single laser module which can continuously tune across the wavelength regions of interest, sort of to replace one module to replace all these varieties of laser modules available. Okay, so the starting point is how do I sort of enhance the efficiency of these cascaded Raman lasers? And it turns out the quantum limited conversion efficiency is relatively high, but the laser provides much lower efficiency. The reason is whenever I have a cascaded Raman resonator, there are all these points, you know, the splices in the fibers, the gratings and so on, which lose a lot of light. But it turns out the question I'm asking is a resonator even necessary to do this cascaded conversion? It turns out at lower powers, it is necessary because when I probe light that is propagating in the cavity, I have Stokes at all the I have light at all the intermediate wavelengths necessary for this cascaded conversion. But at higher powers, most of the light is actually relatively weak at all the intermediate lines. So that gives us an idea that this idea of doing cascaded Raman conversion doesn't really need a resonator. If I go to higher powers and I can maybe do it in a single pass, provided I can seed the cascaded Raman conversion at all the intermediate wavelengths necessary to go from wavelength A to wavelength B. And that's exactly what we did using a newly proposed design called a cascaded Raman amplifier, where we used a low power Raman seed source, which gives me a little bit of power at all the intermediate wavelength regions, combined together with a high power ytterbium doped laser and then sent through this Raman fiber. And what the seed laser does is it gives a little bit of power at all the intermediate regions. And how do I terminate the cascade is by using a fiber which has a natural cutoff. You know, at a certain wavelength, it has this filtering property. So what do I get? So we turned out that with this kind of a system, we were able to get more than a 300 watts of power at the 1.5 micron region at an efficiency very close to the quantum limited efficiency at something like 65%. And this is still, even though it's been 8 or 9 years, the highest power from any fiber laser technology in the ISAFE 1.5 micron region. It turns out that the architecture is relatively stable. So we packaged a 100 watt Raman laser. This was all back during my time when I was a scientist at OFS Laboratories in New Jersey, in the US. When we built these 100 watt boxed modules and we actually sent it to multiple customers, it turns out I recently learned in Photonics West that some of the customers that we actually sent to these lasers, those companies are no more, unfortunately. You know, business is a difficult world, but turns out that the lasers are still okay. So I mean, most of the lasers have sort of outlived the vendors that we shipped them to, unfortunately. So this is sort of what we had, but that's not sufficient. How do I enhance the wavelength agility? I mean, this is going from wavelength A to wavelength B, so I'm still making modules which gives me a single output wavelength, though at higher powers. So all previous architectures had limited wavelength feedback tunability, but Raman gain is available at any wavelength. So can I use tunable pump sources? So what it requires me to have is a single Raman conversion module that can take one wavelength region and tunably convert it into a different wavelength region. So how do I do that is using a grating-free Raman laser so that the wavelength sensitivity of the fiber bra gratings is not there anymore. And the way it turns out, it's very simple. It uses an idea known as distributed random feedback, which was a work that started with Duritzen and continued by Babin and Yan Feng in China and so on. So we use this idea where all I need is to take a high power eta beam doped laser into a wavelength division multiplexer and just put a flat cleave. And flat cleave gives me 4% of Fresnel reflection. And that seeds this half open cavity continuously for Raman conversion. So we completely got rid of the gratings, and this substantially simplified the architecture. So how does it work? So if I use a tunable laser now, I can get a tunable output. So the mechanism is I start with a tunable input laser and it keeps cascading out in the Raman fiber. And then finally, if I can cut off the wavelength conversion at some point, then I will have a tunable laser at the final wavelength region. Now, how do I establish this cutoff? For that, we propose this new design where instead of just a flat feedback, we have a sharp cutoff, a sharp short pass filter, and followed by a sort of a wavelength independent feedback coupler. So this creates this filtered distributed feedback. And physically, the way we implement this is by using a rotating short pass filter wheel together with the filter fiber coiling to create this very sharp cutoff. And we used this with a pump power of something like 90 watts. The output was spectacular. We were able to achieve a 30 watt class laser, which continuously with no gaps could tune a very sizable fraction of the NIR region, starting from 1118 nanometers to 1575 nanometers. So as you can see, the laser has continuously tuned. This is from experiment. It turns out though, I mean, ideally I want all my output power at the final wavelength, but in this case, I'm only getting something like 86%. And we will talk about in this talk, how do I go around it? But before that, I wanted to just bring this very interesting scientific observation we made. All this while I have been talking about near-infrared lasers, and it turns out, I mean, the fibers we use for Raman conversion is passive, right? So if I have a near-infrared laser passing through passive fiber and I take a picture of it, I expect it to be just, you know, how regular fibers look. But if I turn the light off, this is how the laser was looking. I mean, it was a beautiful rainbow of colors with a long exposure. And this baffled us because it's passive fiber and it's a near-infrared laser. So why is it? Why does it have this visual glow with a visible glow going from sort of blue-green all the way to red? We didn't know this, so we sort of poked a visible spectrometer close to this fiber and turns out that we saw discrete lines. So what we are actually seeing is second and third harmonic generation in long length of fiber. And this was very interesting because first of all, these are continuous wave lasers, so it should not be generating at the kind of peak powers sort of any harmonic generation, which is reasonable to observe. And more importantly, second harmonic is unexpected because silica glass doesn't really have a Kaidu coefficient. All right. So all these are discrete orders. And the power, of course, is relatively low. It's like milliwatt class, but still sizable given that our peak powers are only watts here. And it turns out, there is some theory which we were able to find from older publications called there is a way of phase matching harmonic generation in fibers by using a Cherenkov-like effect where a fundamental near-infrared light going in the core can phase match to the second harmonic or the third harmonic in the cladding. And that causes a visible light to form in the cladding, which then is scattering in our case because the cladding has a high index interface. And why do I see this chi2 effect, you know, the second harmonic generation is maybe because of either the core cladding interface, which breaks the centrosymmetry, or sort of a DC assisted chi3 process, which actually looks like a chi2 process locally, right? So what this also allowed us to do is from the picture of the spool, which was glowing in different colors, from a distance, I was able to figure out at what length of the fiber, what is the effective center wavelength of light that is propagating. So it's a sort of a spectral analysis at a distance. After this interesting observation, so coming back to our original problem, how can I make Raman lasers which convert light completely to the final wavelength? And the question we have to ask is, why is there even light which is unconverted when we do this process. And the reason is whenever I look at a cavity-based oscillator, let's say an ytterbium fiber laser, there's always intensity noise. The intensity noise comes because there are multiple lasing modes in these lasers, and then they relatively beat and sort of like a partial coherent source. Any partial coherent source has a natural statistics for noise. And, you know, the slow variations correspond to frequency beating, and the fast variations are related to one over bandwidth. Now, whenever I have Raman scattering, because there is a sort of a group delay mismatch between adjacent stokes, I do get a moving average effect. And when I apply that, as I keep moving my average, my intensity noise sort of reduces, but it doesn't really go away. And what happens is, for all the low power events, because of my intensity noise, I have under-converted light, which is still at the higher frequencies or the lower wavelengths. And then for peak power events, higher peak power events, I have over-conversion. So I basically have under-conversion, I have over-conversion because of intensity noise. So the goal is, how do I reduce intensity noise in my system? And it turns out there is a relatively simple way of doing this, is by developing these lasers based on sort of line broadened using phase modulation of a single frequency laser. The idea is relatively simple. These lasers have no intensity noise and they have very narrow line width. Building these lasers is kind of difficult because these are very high power, high coherence fiber lasers. But we have this extensive program that we relied upon in building such kilowatt class, high power, high coherence lasers for power combining, you know, for power combining, spectral beam combining, coherent beam combining type applications. So we were able to use some source like that. And it turns out we plugged this source into exactly the same Raman conversion module. And what do I get at the output is greater than 99% conversion. So what you see on the left is the input at always at 1.05 micron. At the output, I get lines at all the different Raman conversion orders with more than 99%. So this gives me almost near complete wavelength conversion. And so the idea is, by reducing intensity noise, I have been able to sort of do this pristine conversion from wavelength A to wavelength B in a tunable wave spans the NIR region. So far, I only spoke about the near infrared tuning. And it turns out, once I have roughly an octave level of tuning in one wavelength band, by harmonic generation, either second or third harmonic generation, I can continuously create tunable lasers in the visible, which is a key research topic that we've been working over the last 2 years. But unfortunately, due to the lack of time, I cannot talk about it. Or by using different frequency generation, I can go to the mid-infrared. So the idea is, if I can make a source which is widely tunable nicely in one wavelength domain, I have optical methods of extending that conversion to the other wavelength regions as well, potentially giving me this continuous tuning across a very wide region from the mid-infrared all the way to UV. So in summary, Raman lasers offer an excellent technology to achieve high-power scalability at a wide variety of wavelength regions. And we spoke about our work in enhancing the efficiency, reliability, and system level complexity of these lasers. So what is our final goal? Our final goal is to sort of have this single module which can achieve any power, any wavelength, and any spectral profile out of a single laser module. So I hope I could convince that the uses for such a source is extensive, and hopefully the coming years are going to be an exciting time to work in Raman lasers and applications enabled by it. And with this, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, and I'll be very happy to answer any questions on this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Superdeepa. So it's open for questions, comments. Anybody? Yep. Okay. Here and then.
Okay, congratulations for this prize, dear colleague. So my question is, do you adapt or do you work about the spectral line of your laser, or you don't care about that because you need more power regarding your application?
Yes, this is a very interesting question. So we do care about the line width. For some applications that we use Raman lasers, you know, something like pumping solid state lasers or other fiber lasers for pulsed applications at different wavelength regions, we don't care so much about the line width. But to perform harmonic conversion, of course, we do need narrow line width because that is what is necessary for efficient harmonic conversion and so on. So what, there are multiple types of pump lasers for these, but the narrow line width work that I just spoke about, in addition to creating high spectral purity, it also actually preserves relatively narrow line width in the Raman conversion as well. Not sort of spectroscopically narrow type lasers, but still half a nanometer class line widths or below, which is usually sufficient for pipeline devices to efficiently frequency convert. We have never really worked on true single frequency, you know, this very megahertz class or below line widths for Raman conversion, though we are aware of other groups. But as you rightly mentioned, our focus is mainly on power, provided I have narrow enough line width to be able to do harmonic or difference frequency generation. So we don't worry about line width beyond that point.
Maybe you mentioned and I missed, are these transverse multimode fibers? Is this important? I mean, how then the model noise influences the behavior of the Raman?
No, whatever I have spoken in this talk is completely single mode fiber. So we don't have any multimode effects at all. So the intensity noise that I spoke about is because of this longitudinal modes arising because of just the spectral width being much bigger than the cavity spacing. But there is a very interesting class of work in using multimodal fibers for Raman conversion. There, the main sort of primary goal is, can I directly start with pump diodes, which are highly multimode, and then do multimode Raman conversion to sort of direct Raman without using a rare earth doped intermediate pump. So Professor Babin in Russia is one of the pioneers in this work, and you can probably look it up. He has very interesting work on that. But our work here is at much higher powers. You know, it's an order of magnitude higher powers in the hundreds of watts level. And our fibers are single mode. So our beam qualities are close to 1.05. This is the best possible in a step index fiber.
Okay, thanks. And then just a second, very short question. The interpretation you gave for this visible light generation, second and third harmonic, I remember the past some 20 years ago, there was also this effect of grating formation inside the fiber, which then was leading to the second harmonic. I mean, this was observed in, I don't know, 1 micron laser, then emitting second harmonic in the green. This could also be an effect, I think, in your case, although when you have very broad spectrum, then the grating would kind of smear. So I don't know. But I mean, this is also a possible mechanism, no, for harmonic generation.
Got it. Thank you very much for that suggestion. Yes, so we, as far as the second harmonic is concerned, we still don't know exactly. So we are still sort of searching for answers, and thank you for this direction. So we'll definitely look more into that.
Any more questions? If not, let's thank our 2022.
Thank you very much.
Oh, sorry. Let's not thank you yet. Stay tuned. Last minute question just flew in.
I guess to follow on Mitsuko's question, do you have a mechanism for phase matching the second harmonic generation? Because you could.
You mean in the fibers? Unfortunately, not a a way so far which would be practically interesting. So that's why I sort of look at it as an interesting scientific observation. So the phase matching here, I mean, is exact in the sense that light propagating in the cladding has roughly the right requirements as the near infrared light propagating in the core. But then, you know, the cladding is highly multimoded, so it's not a one-to-one thing. But I can point out in sort of generally in this scheme of things, there is some very interesting work by Siddharth Ramchandran at Boston University, where they have this intermodal four-wave mixing kind of processes, which also can give a visible light from infrared lasers, where the phase matching happens between the infrared light in sort of the lower modes with the visible light in higher order modes in an optical fiber. So there is work like that, but anyway, that requires higher peak power, so it's mainly done with femtosecond lasers, but that allows you to sort of controllably phase match near infrared light with visible light using sort of modal degeneracy.
You might want to check some really old work by Roger Stolen on some of this work in single mode silica fibers. He's done some experiments, but it's a long time ago.
Got it. Of course, I have met Roger Stolen, and he's sort of the big person who started Raman scattering in fibers, and I'd be very happy to follow your suggestion more on that.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Any more? I'm looking around the entire room this time. No? Okay, this time let's thank our 2022 winner.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Okay, the last but not least, now we come to the present day. And so we have the 2023 recipient of the ICO-ICTP Gallieno Denardo Award, and that's Mohammed Kasim Mehmood. So please. And in the meantime, you should all start combing your hair because we'll have the group photo to the conclusion. Yeah, I wish I had a comb. Obviously, I don't have a comb.
Hello, is it okay?
Yeah. I see them.
Can I see the pointer? The red dot.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. So I will start with a verse from famous poet Iqbal. New words drive their pomp from fresh and new thoughts. From stones and bricks, a word was neither built nor grew. With this, my name is Kasim. I'm working as an associate professor at Information Technology University, Lahore, Pakistan. Before moving forward, I would like to thank my institute, ITU, Information Technology University, and Higher Education Commission, Pakistan, for supporting all this research since last 6 to 7 years. Meanwhile, I would like to say thanks to ICTP, ICO for honoring me with this award to acknowledge the struggle which I did since last 6 to 7 years while staying in a developing country like a Pakistan. Last but not the least, I would like to thank OSA and SPIE societies we have student chapters from these societies at our home institute for providing resources and support to do all the different sort of activities. Thank you, all of you. Here are my outlines. I will start with the introduction of Micro Nano Lab. I am one of the directors of this lab. Then introduction and motivation for my topic, and then research highlights, few of them, and different events and outreach which we do at our home institute and country, and then I will conclude. I am from Pakistan, which is a South Asian country, neighboring India, China, Afghanistan, and Iran. So we are over here. Despite all the challenges and odds, few rose to the global level to promote science and peace beyond the local borders. Naming a few great scientists and physicists, Professor Abdus Salam, great education activist Malala Yousafzai, and great humanitarian Abdustar Edi, who devoted their lives for science and peace. There are few things which are vital in creating a soft image of our country, starting from sports to few highlighted exports. We have international good team for cricket who won a couple of World Cups and ICC Champions Trophy. We have won field hockey 4 times. And then we were football exporter for FIFA World Cups. And there are a few highlighted ones. Now about me, I did my PhD from National University of Singapore from 2011 to 2016. And after finishing my PhD, I started my journey as assistant, and then back in 2021, I was promoted as associate professor. And my area of research mainly stick with matter devices, light matter interaction at a nanoscale. And I'm one of the directors of this micro nano lab. Here are few topics which we do at our lab. So we actually categorize these topics in 2 domains. One is for indigenous usage and one is for science and research. For indigenous development, we do customized projects like customized intelligent microscopy. We do high and low frequency electronics for few local projects for indigenous benefits. And for science, we do projects like MetaMogus for smart and rapid designs for meta optical systems, meta absorbers for high energy, for energy harvesting, meta lensing based imaging systems, and reconfigurable intelligent surfaces for Li-Fi. This is our lab's website and Facebook page. The existing HR student and staff strength is 22 roughly, out of which we have 8 PhD students, 11 master's students, and 3 research associates. We have, well, gender equality. Out of these, 10 are female students, which make the 45% of the overall strength. So I also want to thank ICTP for providing me opportunity to attend this school and why this was important for me, because we mainly focus on electronics and photonics, and there was a missing link for terahertz to fill this particular gap. These are a few projects which we did over the years for electronics. And I, as I have mentioned, for the photonic side, we do the development of meta surfaces based devices like microscopy, like light structuring, holography, et cetera. We are not in isolation. We are collaborating from east to west, from academia to industry, to skill our students with the state of the art technologies and science, where they can secure jobs once they finish their studies. So we always go with the slogan, learn to earn. It's not moving. Still stuck. Okay, this is the research output from electronics to photonics. We were able to publish the top venues, including Nature Publishing Group, ACS, YLA, Optica, Royal Society of Chemistry, and APS, etc. Few of our works were also highlighted in as a cover page in Nanoscale Horizon, Advanced Materials, Advanced Optical Materials, and Nanoscale. Now, I will go towards the introduction and motivation of why we want to do meta devices. I think we have heard a lot about this optical constants. It has real and imaginary part. Real part actually controls the velocity, in other words, phase, while the imaginary part is responsible for the absorption in a certain material. So if I take a linearly polarized light, so we have three fundamental characteristics of the wave: polarization, magnitude, and its phase. Okay, I can use this. So all of us familiar with famous Snell's law, which is Snell's law of reflection and refraction for a given medium. So for given refractive indices, light go from one medium to another medium at a fixed location for a given system. And most importantly, this is propagation effect, and we can manipulate the wavefronts of light by using the refractive indices as well as thickness of the material. This is how most of the optical components work. Then it came 2011 when Professor Capasso's group from Harvard University, they introduced this generalized law of reflection and refractions, in other words, generalized Snell's law. And the law was about introducing an abrupt phase change between the two media through sub-wavelength resonators like this. The benefit of doing this kind of thing is shrinking the size to a sub-wavelength scale and enabling a planar flat optical devices and systems. So metamaterials are beyond natural materials, which can exhibit properties most of the times, which are not possible by natural materials to show. And it is a more broader term, whereas metasurfaces is the specialized version of metamaterials, where we talk about surfaces which can show effect, which are not possible generally through a naturally occurring materials. So if we see the comparison of natural to metamaterials, natural materials to metamaterials. In natural materials, we have atoms. In metamaterials, the fundamental unit is subwavelength metaatoms, we call them. There are a few examples of metamaterials and metasurfaces over here. Now, to give the motivation why we want to go for meta surfaces and meta devices and meta optical systems, I have taken a couple of examples from Thor Labs. So if we look at a convex lens, so thickness is roughly 4.2 millimeter for the wavelengths from 350 to 700 nanometer. So if I take a central more or less wavelength, so the thickness becomes 8400 lambda, which is approximately 10 raised to power 4 lambda. However, if I go to an objective lens, which is a system of train of lenses, now the thickness is around 45.06 mm, which is this much, 10 raised to power approximately 5 lambda. However, for the meta devices, we can go to the scale of single wavelengths. In other words, we can get a size reduction from 10 raised to power 4 to 10 raised to power 5 times. Now, if we look at the conventional optical systems, which are a combination of conventional optical components, obviously, once we will be using conventional optical devices, we will have bulky systems like this, microscopy, cameras, AR, VR, goggles, spectrometers, etc. And if we can build such systems using meta devices, obviously we can go to an enormous size reduction. Owing to the motivation that was back in 2016, where people started thinking, bringing such meta devices into industry for real-time optical, real-time applications. This whole area was actually kicked off by Professor Capasso, and Mr. Rob is his student. So they are doing different sort of meta lenses and all that. So far the story is combining the functional of five optical elements into a single meta optical device. So that is a kind of upper limit as of now. What does that mean? If we want to bring such systems into a chip scale, we need new strategies, new technologies, new underlying physics to further squeeze the size of system and integrate multiple meta devices into a single device. In other words, to introduce multifunctional meta devices. So if we want to go for meta devices and meta optical systems, however, and for the mass acceptance of such systems, the foremost important thing is rapid design. So conventionally, people use computational softwares like FDTD, Lumerical, etc. But their optimization requires a long time, really long time. Which means we need to come up with, to break the current limits, we need to come up with new design strategies. We need to come up some rapid development and design procedures, and we have to develop large scale fabrication techniques. And then we have to integrate such devices to come up with a compact optical systems. So generally the procedure is we develop the underlying physics, we optimize meta atoms, and then we get this required phase profiles for a given meta device, and then we arrange these meta atoms into such kind of two-dimensional periodic or aperiodic array according to the given phase mask, and then our device is ready, and then we do the optimization of train of devices for a given optical system. This is a few of our works in terms of optimization, where we use AI for optimization. This first work was using images where we have three layers of information providing height and structural parameters and all that. And eventually we wanted to predict the absorption response of such system. And once we are able to get this kind of optimization, we apply this sort of transfer learning to the other materials and other shapes to identify the effectivity of our models. Once this thing was done for magnitude optimization, the second thing we wanted to go for phase optimization as well, where and we also wanted to have a both ways, forward prediction and a reverse prediction. So for a given parameters like length, width, height, and periodicity, we wanted to have the phase and magnitude of that kind of structure. And then other way around, if we are given with the phase and magnitude of the response, we can predict the structural parameters. And this work was highlighted in Nanoscale, recently published. Now we are working, obviously this is a kind of ever-growing story. Now we are working to develop this kind of metamogus. In antennas, we have antennamogus where if we give a specific kind of requirements, so it can build the whole system. So now the whole optical system will include optimization of meta atoms and then arrangement of such meta atoms for a given device or a phase profile, and then putting all these devices together into a system. So that is a really useful, that could be a real useful tool. Now, coming towards this underlying principle, so I have taken one of the meta atoms which we excessively used, that is this kind of bars, as this is an anisotropic kind of structure, non-Smith. So it behaves as a nano half-wave plate. So as we know that half-wave plates change left-hand circular polarization into right-hand circular polarization. So similarly, this kind of nanobar structures, nano half-wave plate perform the similar kind of effects. However, the advantage is once this kind of bars convert one polarization, circular polarization to other circular polarization, we also get this kind of additional phase which corresponds to the rotation of such bars. We can understand the underlying mechanism through this even and odd anti-parallel parallel magnetic dipoles. If we see we have on the longer side, we have like four anti-parallel magnetic dipoles. So EX, if entering EX on this side, on the other side, it always stays in the same direction. However, if we are looking at the other side, so EY is reversing the sign, which means we are getting other handedness of the polarization in case of circular. So it means we can encode any phase profile of any component in such kind of nano half-wave plates. We tried different sorts of phase profile integration like spherical lens, spiral phase plates, Bessel beams, et cetera. And there are experimental and published results of these. We wanted to go to add further functionalities into such devices. And we came up with a strategy of spin decoupled design where in a single bar, we can use it for both sort of handedness, and we can add, you see, in a single bar for left-hand polarization and for right-hand polarization, we can add different functionalities, and each handedness can even have multiple functionalities into that, which means a single bar can be used for multifunctional, as a multifunctional meta device. Similarly, our recent work is going on towards building different sorts of achromat. If we talk about achromat lens, so we have a spherical lens profile. And then once we change the wavelengths because of this achromatic aberration, there is a delta phase shift between the maximum and the minimum wavelengths. And we need some sort of phase compensation. Is it stuck or something? Similarly, we have also proposed diatomic structures where we can have now more degree of freedom to add different sort of functionalities, and we have demonstrated chirality and broadband meta devices for using this kind of strategies. So if you are, any one of you are interested, you can come and we can discuss further, because over here, I might not be able to cover all of the techniques we have developed. So as I have mentioned, that for such kind of meta devices and meta optical systems require a train of research ideas, including material research, novel theories to break the current limits, smart design and optimization, developing large scale meta devices, meta system design and development, and then we use such systems for some real-time applications like intelligent meta microscopy for autonomous diagnostics or some other kind of applications. So we will be very happy to collaborate with students, with professors, mentors, and with industry and some other kind of collaborators. So I would like to shed some light on the events or different kind of outreach activities which we do from our platform. We have active OSA and SPE student chapter where I'm advisor and co-advisor, and these are different members of our teams with some different roles for different chapters. Over the years, we actively involved for different kind of events that includes organizing symposiums, national and international symposiums. We have this upcoming symposium, which we are working with different universities in Pakistan to organize in our ITU main campus that will be in March 2023. And apart from that, we have several other events like seminars, series, International Day of Light competitions, like poster competitions for other type of presentation competitions, photo contest, etc. And then we have regular talks and webinars and seminars from these OSA, SPE, and HAC funded activities. These are few pictures from our events. These pictures were taken from these lecture series, and this was there are a few from the invited talks and seminars. And recently, we have also started one program where we want to go to the government schools, because in our side there are some deficiency of experiments and all that. So what we did is for the Inter and for ninth and 10th student, we started to kind of developing experiments for them. Those experiments which they are unable to do in their school because of lack of equipments. So we went on to different schools to do these kinds of experiments and activities. And apart from that, we also go for excursion and different kind of trips to have fun, apart from doing these academic activities. These are a few highlighted alumni I would like to mention. Dr. Afnan, he finished a PhD with me and with one of my colleague, Dr. Tosif. He stayed at MITU. We were working in collaboration with one university in Turkey. And currently he's doing a postdoctoral researcher in Harriet Watt University. During the course of his PhD, he was able to publish at a prestigious venues, including Advanced Materials, Science Advances, and some other kind of top venues. Dr. Essen is the second PhD student from me. He finished his PhD in 2021 and currently working as an assistant professor at Air University, one of the top public sector universities in Pakistan. During the course of his PhD, he was working in collaboration with National University of Singapore, where we will be doing lots of experiments and all that. And he physically visited as a research attachment at that university. Dr. Nasser, he also finished PhD back in 2020. And currently he joined recently, just in January, as a postdoctoral researcher at King Abdullah University of Science and Technology with one of our collaborators. And these are kind of venues where he has published his research works, including nanoletters, nanoscales, et cetera. Dr. Saad finished PhD in 2020, and currently he joined as a postdoctoral researcher at KNU. He was at KAUST during the course of his PhD towards the end of his PhD. And similarly, Tamur finished his PhD in 2022, and he joined as assistant professor at one of the public sector universities in Pakistan. So far, since 2016, we were able to produce 5 PhD students. Three of them have joined as a postdoctoral researchers at overseas university, and 2 of them joined as assistant professors in Pakistani universities, and all of them are very active in research. We were able, from our micro nano lab, we were able to produce 17 master's students, and we take the pride that all of them are having decent jobs, or either they are pursuing higher studies. And we were able to produce 18 undergraduate theses. And we have kind of well-balanced gender equality as well. With this, I would like to conclude by saying that as the nature of project, and there are lots of other projects which are going on, so obviously there are lots of possibilities to collaborate, and we have also started this kind of outreach and social impact and that sort of activities. I would like to invite you to collaborate, students, mentors, industry, humanitarian. So at the end, I would like to say, let's join hands to use science as a tool to propagate peace, harmony, and love beyond social, religious, and territorial boundaries. Thank you very much.
Very nice message to close with. Thank you. All right, open for questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kassin, for a nice presentation. I don't have a question. It's just a comment that the new name of OSA is Optica. We don't call it OSA anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's just Optica. Yes. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Optica has a response to that. Any questions? Any other questions? Yep.
Could you give a little more detail on your metasurfaces based on AI neural networks? You showed some slides on metasurfaces. Yeah, could you just give a little more detail how those work and what kind of simulation softwares you use for those?
Oh, okay. So yes, as I have mentioned, we use this kind of AI deep learning methods for 2 kinds of things. One is optimization of unit cell, and it is we use Google Colab because it is free, and Python obviously. And then there are 2 different types of techniques where you use image-based techniques to extract the features to extract, and also kind of if you want to get those kinds of feature image-based techniques for unit cell optimization. So because if we use a CST or Lumericals, generally if we go for a specific material, so it takes like 1 month for all these optimization. And you also need a license for such kind of, to use such kind of softwares. However, if you are using AI, obviously you need your brain, that's all. And the biggest advantage apart from that is the rapidness. For example, once you have this kind of training network, it hardly takes like a few minutes to get the desired parameters. And another very important advantage for this kind of deep learning techniques, you see, for example, if we are using a conventional software. So for example, if you change the spectrum, you change the material, you change the scenario. So every time you have to re-optimize, which means you go in the cycle of same, like 1-2 months of optimization. So this is one, like unit cell optimization. And then the second thing is making the complete device. So for example, if you want to build an achromat, multifunctional achromat, some other holography, et cetera. And now you see, once we have optimized meta atoms, then you have to place those meta atoms to build the device. Now the second phase is to train your algorithms for a given phase masks, for a given phase mask, so that you can get such kind of distribution. So it's more like a unit cell and material optimization towards the device optimization for a desired goal. Yeah, that kind of thing. We can further discuss, I mean, if you are interested.
Yeah. Another question?
Thank you. Thank you for the nice talk. I was just curious, let's say, this is a further step compared to the meta optics after, for example, diffraction optics now, because I heard similar statement like 20 years ago that diffraction optics is going to replace conventional optics now. And it didn't, for some reasons that I haven't analyzed, but it seems that you cannot, although everything seems possible theoretically, then there are limitations on the real life production of these components. So I was wondering, are there fundamental limitations also here, or there is a real possibility that because you are sub-wavelength, then you don't have some of the limitations met, that diffraction optic has,
yes.
So that at one point we really see achromatic lenses made this way, no?
Yes, yes. Thanks. I would say that at a fundamental level, at the design level, there are, to be honest, no certain limitations. And with the growth of these theories can be built. The actual limitation is technological restrictions, how far we can go. So currently, if we can go for the wafer technology, such kind of devices will eventually come. And actually it is coming with the passage of time, because conventionally to build this kind of techniques, people use electron beam lithography, and which cannot build the big structures, but now people are going for nano imprinting and some other devices to build the bigger devices. So the point is, technology is rapidly evolving in this direction. And I believe, not only believe, and I think it is very much possible. Obviously, it cannot replace the whole optical systems, but at several places, you can put such kind of meta lenses and meta devices to shrink the sizes. Yes.
Another question? Well, anyway, Kazim, I really, I like your message, and I think it's, you know, it's obvious for us that we can, we're all here from many different cultures, religions, and places, and it's absolutely obvious that we're communicating about the same thing.
Yes.
Our slides could be interchanged, but that's perhaps not obvious to everybody, but I think scientists are really setting an example for the rest of humanity, just because we're just doing it. I think it just comes natural for us, but I think it's a very important message. I think, I hope peace will come, yes. And especially in your region, because that's, we know it's just been difficult. So thank you again. Let's thank Kazim again for a wonderful talk. And now, did you get your hair combed? Yeah, okay. Straighten out your shirts. Everybody come down.